I've tried to stop dreaming of. You were only fooling me while I was falling in love. But I was falling in love. It's a story as old as Adam and Eve. I was making love, but you were making believe. You lied to me with kisses.
Mama better be careful, huh?
I've tried.
There!
WRCW's Brooklyn English?
No, not there. There on the bottom. The woman of the year.
Hold on.
You have reached a new low. Hang up.
Hang up.
Now what? I'm speaking of your attempting to hype yourself into being woman of the year.
Oh, Erica, I had nothing to do with that ad. That was all Adam's idea.
Well, I want you both to know that neither one of you is going to get away with any of your cheap, underhanded tricks.
Hi, Erica.
He's a law associate of Link's. This is my niece, Brooke English.
Mr. Chambers, nice to meet you.
Link filled me in on your situation. I hope I can help.
I hope so, too. Mr. Chambers, do you think I can get my daughter back?
It's not a cut-and-dried situation. If there's any way you can avoid going to court, you'd be better off. I mean, it could be brutal, even worse than a divorce. I'm sure you wouldn't want to subject your daughter to that sort of thing.
No, I certainly don't want to go to court. But believe me, I will go to court if that's what I have to do, because I will do anything to get my daughter back.
Well, then you'd best prepare yourself for an uphill battle.
Well, why is that?
Well, look at the facts. Miss English, you have a very high profile. You're on television daily. Well, your involvement with Mr. St. Clair, the two of you living what most people consider a jet-setting existence.
Well, why should that have any bearing on whether I get my daughter back or not?
Exactly.
A lot of people have busy careers and they have active social lives.
Not for a woman with a very young child and an ex-husband who disapproves her lifestyle.
Brooke, Mr. Chambers does have a valid point.
Don't you think that I'm going to be able to get her back?
I'm saying there's a chance you won't win. Miss English, what about this Woman of the Year contest that's getting all this media attention?
What about it?
Well, do you have any real desire to win it? A custody case would generate a lot of unflattering publicity.
Mr. Chambers, look, I don't give a damn about this competition. The only thing I want to do is get my daughter back home again.
Well, then I suggest that you think about what's best for your daughter. And after you've given it some serious thought, if you still want to proceed, I'll be more than happy to represent you.
So then you do think that I have a chance?
You have a chance, but it's like I said, if you can avoid going to court, you'd be better off.
All right, Mr. Chambers, thank you very much, and I'll call you in the morning.
Good night, then.
Thank you.
Brooke, darling, if you want me to go with you to the police station in the morning, maybe we'll see if they can make Tom give Laura back to you.
Why don't we talk in the morning? I'm worn out.
Oh, darling, I can understand that. Try to get some sleep, sweetheart.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Good night, Mrs. Wellingford.
Believe me, I wouldn't be here unless it were important.
Well, we all know everything you do is important.
I would like to know why you didn't show up last night at the press conference in New York for the nominees for Woman of the Year.
I couldn't make it.
Oh, well, you certainly were the only one who couldn't. Were you very ill?
I just couldn't make it.
My, 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 such a cavalier attitude. Well, one would think that you didn't even care about the nomination.
I never asked for it.
Well, with that attitude, Brooke, why don't you just drop out?
If I dropped out of the race.
Oh, I think it would be a way for you to save face. We both know very well that if you stay in, you'll lose.
Well, I think of it as a horse race. So, I'm very sorry, but I can't accommodate you because I'm in to stay.
Boy, you are such a hypocrite, Brooke. You pretend you don't care. But the reality is you are desperate to win. You know you have to do something dramatic to help your sinking career.
Oh, no, you're very much mistaken. My career is alive and well.
Your ratings are so low you can't even measure them.
Well, ratings go in cycles.
Oh, tell that to the stockholders. I can certainly understand why Adam is pumping millions into your campaign. Of course, it's all quite futile. My tempo readers are far too sophisticated to be taken in by that hype.
You know, I think it would be really very nice to win. I think it would help a lot of other people.
Oh, I see. Oh, perhaps you should have been nominated for sainthood, not Woman of the Year.
Well, you know, you were right before about one thing. The ratings. The ratings are a little down. But see, it would be great if I could do something to help that. Because there are a lot of people whose livelihoods depend on, you know, how well the station does.
Oh, come on. The only livelihood you are interested in is your own.
No, Erica. I'm going to survive whether I win or lose. You are the one who needs to win in order to survive.
That is nonsense. I have a very far-ranging career. I don't need to win this contest.
Maybe not, but I think your ego needs to win this contest. Because I think you would be driven into the ground if you lost a contest that was run by your own magazine. Not to mention, if you lost to me, it would be devastating.
Well, it'll never happen.
It could. And that is why you came to ask me to drop out of the race.
Well, I just don't believe this whole thing. You'll never win. I mean,
so you're scared of losing that you cannot see
strength. Erica, wow, you look more beautiful than ever. Please come in.
Oh, you flatterer. You always are, but I love it.
You flatter me by your visit.
Well, I have some business I would like to discuss with you.
Well, I'm always open for business. Please sit down.
Thank you. Actually, we at Tempo Magazine are thinking of doing an article on the three handsomest men in the whole world. Naturally, I would like to include you.
Well, Erica, you flatter me again, but I'm not interested in some male beauty contest. You know, for me, it's what's in the heart that counts.
Oh, yes. Oh, that's right, Gilles. But it doesn't hurt to package a kind heart with a beautiful face, does it?
Mm-hmm.
So please, you must contact Dabney very, very soon. Now tell me, are you babysitting for Laura today?
No. No, little Laura will stay with Tom for a while.
No. Oh, I'm surprised.
Well, frankly, I'm very disappointed about Tom. When I first met him, I thought he was okay. But now I see he can be very cruel.
You don't mean to tell me that he is keeping Laura against Brooke's wishes?
Well, this is none of my business, but I would like to put the goods on him and then fix his wagon.
Well, don't forget, I was married to Tom. I mean, if anybody can get the goods on him, it's me.
Then you must do me a big favor. Give me the ammunition to zap him with.
Oh, I will. I mean, I know that I can. But first, I really have to know what is going on exactly between Tom and Brooke and little Laura.
I can't believe my ears. You mean that Tom is actually threatening to sue for custody of Laura on the grounds that Brooke is an unfit mother?
That's so unfair. He's a creep.
Oh, yes. He was always a creep when he was married to me. I mean, he was very self-centered, always just involved with himself, just the way he is now.
Well, Erica, now you must tell me something I can use against him.
Oh, yes. Oh, I know that I can think of something really bad about Tom, really very, very heavy, something that would really destroy him for good. Mm. But you have to give me a little time, all right? I'm sorry, I must run just now because I have a business appointment.
Okay, you call me soon on that.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I'll call you very, very soon.
Okay.
And don't worry, I'm going to come up with something on Tom that's going to make your hair just stand right out. So, au revoir. A bientôt.
Nice to see you. Bye.
Bye.
Merci beaucoup, Jean Sinclair. You have given me exactly what I need. Well, just wait till the world finds out that Brooke English is an unfit mother.
She won't know you, you know.
How can you be so sure?
Well, because she said the other day that she thought that she ought to get out and make some friends in Pine Valley, so obviously...
It wouldn't hurt to see if she does recognize me. And Daisy thinks that I might be right on the edge of her memory.
Oh, Daisy, well... She's on the edge herself. She's so emotionally upset, she really doesn't know what she's doing.
Well, Cliff thinks it's a good idea, too.
Oh, Cliff, that big expert. He's a surgeon. He knows little or nothing about psychiatry.
Well, do you know anything about it?
At least I'm very close to her, and Cliff has barely seen her. I'm sure you're aware of the violent reaction that she had when she did see him.
Palmer. Do you remember when Nina first fell in love with Cliff and the violent reaction that you had?
It's neither here nor there.
No, but you were furious at me for helping them get together.
Well, you were a little wild then. And I didn't think you were a good influence on my daughter.
Well, you did everything you could do to intimidate me, but it didn't do anything to break up our friendship.
I wasn't doing anything except trying to protect a very sheltered girl.
Father?
I'm ready. Hello, Nina. Brooke? Yes, Nina.
You seem confused, Nina.
I'm sorry. You know, for the life of me, I can't place where I know you from. Did we go to school together in Switzerland?
No, I've never been to Switzerland.
You look so familiar. Of course! Of course you're on television. You have that news show. It's very good.
Yes, that's right, Nina. Brooke is an anchor person on WRCW.
And you must be discussing business. I'm sorry I interrupted.
No, not at all. Excuse me, Father. I'll see you outside.
That's right, darling. Well, I'm sorry, Brooke. That must have been very disconcerting for you. I wish you'd taken my advice and not pushed this meeting.
Well, I just realized how painful it must be for Cliff and Daisy to look in Nina's eyes and not see any sign of recognition.
Hmm. Well, at least Nina is herself otherwise. I mean, you really don't know what agony is until you've seen her in that totally catatonic state.
Well, why didn't Dr. Wald work with her any longer so he could bring her closer to the present?
Well, her memory will come back, but we mustn't push it. You see, I see it as Nina having a second chance to come up to the present. But this time, she'll be much stronger.
Yes, well, that's a very interesting concept. I'm not sure that it works that way.
Well, I intend that she get all the love and attention I can give her. Now, if you'll excuse me.
I did want to speak to Daisy before.
Oh, well, she's upstairs lying down. She's had a very trying day. And I'm about to go riding.
It's about your interview for WRCW. I was assigned to come over and...
Well, surely not to do it in my hotel room.
Oh, no, of course not. I just need to get some background information on you for the interview itself.
This is most unprofessional. Couldn't you have called first?
Well, ordinarily I would have called, but I just took a chance that you would be here because I'm a little short on time. This was pushed on me at the last minute.
Roget Jewelry does not need to beg for publicity. Don't you know we are in the fashion news from New York to San Francisco? We are the Reg.
Maybe you could give me some of your reasons why you think the line is caught on so well. In fact, if you could describe some of the jewelry to me, or maybe if you have some samples you could show me.
You don't even know what the line looks like?
No, I've never seen the line. That's why I'm here. I would like to make my interview a little more knowledgeable.
Well, never mind. You can simply introduce me, and then I will take it from there. I have some wonderful examples to show.
I don't think you understand. You see, this is going to be an interview. It's not a commercial for your jewelry.
How dare you? I have done interviews in New York, Paris, London. Pardon. Hello? Spiros, why do you have to keep calling me? You are only tormenting yourself. I have business. Stop bothering me. Ex-husbands can be such a bore, can't they? Now, where were we?
We were discussing the interview.
Just leave everything to me. It will be fabulous.
You know, I was very surprised that you decided to stay in Pine Valley, particularly since Gilles refused your offer to invest in his stunt.
Well, Gilles is so exciting, I couldn't leave without seeing him perform.
Well, I'm sure he'll be very flattered to hear that. Now, if you could give me some background information on your business, it would be great. I'm sure it would help me make this interview a lot more interesting.
Well, I disagree. I think an interview is much more interesting when it is spontaneous.
Well, there'll be a lot of time for spontaneity. You see, I don't want this interview to turn into a monologue because I will be asking questions.
Well, that's just fine because I have the answers to any silly question you want to ask me.
The reason I'm here is so that I can get information so that my questions will be more informed. Do you understand that?
I am so sorry that I don't have the time to do your work for you, but as you can see, I was in the midst of my beauty rest. So please, Brooke, do me a favor and run along.
Ah, Solange, you are formidable.
Okay, quiet on the set, everybody. Stand by. 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello again, this is Brooke English, and here with me today is renowned French jewelry designer Solange Chevalier. Welcome, Solange.
Thank you, Brooke. I'm happy to be here.
How did you become a jewelry designer?
Well, first of all, I did not simply take an arts and crafts course as one might do in this country. I developed a sensibility to beautiful design through exposure to French painting, sculpture, architecture. One must first develop a refined taste before one can work successfully with precious metals and jewels.
Your taste is impeccable.
Thank you. I like to think it extends even to the men in my life.
No doubt. I'd like to ask you a personal question. Suppose a woman in our viewing audience has some odd pieces of jewelry around and she would like to
have a new piece created from them, how should she go about finding a designer to create this piece for her?
Well, first and foremost, she should look for a continental designer. If not French, then Italian or even Spanish.
Why is that?
Well, my dear, because the American designers simply have not yet matured in imagination and quality. The only American designers I would recommend are the American Indians in the Southwest. Forgive me for being frank, but I think that American women have so much to learn about how to please and excite a man. They seem to be lacking in a sense of romance, mystery, and adventure.
Shall we stick to jewelry?
It's my passion. But let me make one other point. The most exciting moment in wearing a piece of jewelry is not when you put it on, but when it is taken off by the right man. Don't you have any more questions, Brooke? Or did the cat get your tongue?
Come on, what is she doing? Doesn't she know this thing? Come on, speak up!
Frank, but you know, American women have so much to learn about the art of pleasing and exciting men. They seem to lack a sense of romance, mystery, passion, adventure. You seem as if you don't agree, Brooke.
I not only don't agree, I think that your remarks are totally chauvinistic, and I think an apology is called for.
An apology? What for? I merely express my opinion, and that is what I'm here for, n'est-ce pas?
You are not here to denigrate American women. Nor did anyone ask your opinion on the art of handling a man.
You seem to be so personally involved in this, Brooke. Is there some sort of a problem? Surely a woman of your great talent and beauty isn't having some self-doubt about her ability to handle a man. Maybe it's full.
Mais qu'est-ce que c'est?
The Brooke English show will continue with this riveting discussion when we return.
We're into a commercial.
I don't have to stand for this kind of abuse.
I'm very sorry. I don't know what's happened. I'm terribly sorry.
I am going to call up my lawyer.
No, we're going to have an apology right on the air right this minute.
You are going to be a lot sorrier.
No.
What's wrong with you, huh? Don't you realize we're doing a live television show?
I'm well aware of that.
You know what you're going to do? After this commercial's over, you're getting on that television set and you're apologizing and you're explaining your behavior to this audience.
I had a good reason for doing what I did. And I'm not trying to apologize.
You're taking over this show.
No problem there, Ross. Sorry, Brooke.
My guest.
Five. I promise you, you are fired.
You're not going to fire me. I quit.
Two. One.
Hey there, hi, and welcome back to the Brooke English Show. Of course, I'm Brian Sanders. I bet you're saying, by golly, Brian, what are you doing there? I don't know. Well, Brooke and her guest are out getting fitted for some boxing gloves, and, well, by golly, we've got a little time to kill here, and why don't we open up the phones there, Ben, and we'll take some calls from the Pine Valley. We're not set up for calls, okay, well. Felix, folks, I'd like you to meet my floor manager here. This is Mr. Felix Peck, a heck of a nice guy. Felix, you knucklehead, I'm going to put you on television. I want you to share with the folks your anecdotes, something, sort of an insight into the wonderful, wacky world, the zany world of studio and traffic coordination here at WRCW. The floor is yours, Felix. Enjoy.
Brooke, what happened? I could not believe my eyes when I saw you slap Solange on television. What did she do to deserve such treatment?
As if you didn't know. You've been sleeping with Solange.
Brooke, what are you saying?
You, please don't pretend. I saw you and Solange together.
You saw what?
I came back to the apartment to pick up some papers, and I saw the two of you making love in my bed.
Then why didn't you say something?
What am I supposed to say? Would you mind making love somewhere else, as I'm sure you've been doing?
Brooke, you are the one I love.
I don't believe that. Gee, what kind of a man are you?
I needed more money for the stunt. Solange forced me.
Oh, what did she do? Rape you?
I have no choice. This jump is so important.
So you sold your services? What are you worth? Do I owe you anything, or was the $5,000 I paid you enough?
Brooke, I do love you.
You don't love me. You love yourself. I was convenient to you. What is it?
Brooke, you sound upset.
I'm all right. Who is this?
This is Adam Chandler. I'd like you to come over to the mansion. I need to talk with you.
What's the point? Haven't I already messed things up enough?
Well, I'd like to try to help you get out of this mess.
All right, I'll be right over.
Where was that?
I might be able to salvage my career. And when I get back, I want you packed and I want you out.
Who was it?
It's somebody who'll get back to you later.
Brooke, I feel that I've had a dagger thrust into my heart after the confidence I've placed in you. Not to mention the money I've spent promoting you for Woman of the Year.
I'm sorry I let you down, Adam.
Well, Brooke, I want to defend your action and keep you on. Now, let's forget Corinne for a moment, shall we? And Roland, please. I'm quite serious, Brooke. This is an option that I would love to exercise. But you're going to have to give me some kind of a reasonable justification for slapping this woman in the face on live television.
You want an apology.
What I want is a valid explanation why this woman provoked you into this unorthodox behavior on an air show.
It's personal, Adam.
Oh, Brooke, don't hide behind pride now.
It's not a matter of hiding behind pride. It's a matter of protecting my right to privacy.
Oh, Brooke, stop it. What are you going to do, take the First Amendment? You don't care about this job. You never did. Why don't you admit it?
That's not true. I care about this job very much. I don't want to lose this job. But I will not compromise myself either in order to keep it.
All right, all right. Brooke, bottom line. Either you give me a plausible rationale for having attacked this woman, or I'm going to have to accept your resignation as final.
Brooke, I think that's a very generous offer.
Yes, it is, but I can't accept it.
Brooke, I know you. I know you'd never lose control without a damn good reason.
There was a good reason, but I'm not going to spill my personal life to you or to anyone.
Then you leave me no choice. I have to cut off all ties between you and WRCW, and that includes the syndicated talk show.
Well, Ross, I guess you got what you want. You've been gunning for me a long time to get me out of here.
Bro, please stop it. I'm not the one who made an idiot of myself on a television show.
Well, it doesn't make any difference. You still got what you wanted. I'm surprised at you, Adam. You own this station. One word from you and I could be back at my job and no questions asked.
I gave you every chance, Brooke.
I would think you, of all people, would know that there are some things that no one would want made public. But no, you can't go out on a limb for me. For what you know is my right. You have to knuckle under to your nephew. What kind of a man are you?
That woman just finished herself in the entire broadcast industry.
Brooke, thank heavens. Where are you, darling? Are you all right?
I'm at Willow Lake. Yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, God. We are worried sick about you. In fact, Lieutenant Callahan was just about to send out an APB.
Oh, don't do that. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I didn't call you. I had to get away.
Because of that foolish TV program? Oh, darling, that's nonsense. It didn't mean a thing.
It's more than that. Sheila and I broke up, and anyway, I drove up here yesterday afternoon, and I lay down for a short nap, and
I fell asleep, and I slept through the night. I just woke up now. Listen, how is Laura?
Oh, Laura's fine, sweetheart. Tom's with her. She's with him. Of course, you know that. But how about you? Are you coming home soon?
I think maybe I'll stay up here a couple of days.
I just need time, you know, to be by myself. This is a good place to sort of sort things out.
Well, darling, I'm not sure about that. I don't think it's safe. A young woman alone in a deserted cabin and then...
No, it's fine. It's fine. There's heat. There's some food still in the freezer.
Well, I just wish you were coming right back here. Oh, Brooke, dear, there's someone here who wants to say hello. Just a minute.
Brooke, it's Tom.
Are you sure you're all right?
Yeah, I'm positive. Is Laura okay?
She misses you.
I miss her. Listen, when I get back, can we talk about her coming back to me?
You can talk about anything you want to.
Okay. Give her my love. And, I'll see you soon.
Sooner the better.
Okie doke. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Tom, didn't you forget to tell her something?
What's that?
That you love her.
She doesn't want to hear that, Phoebe. Look, I better call Lieutenant Callahan and call off the...
I've never been so happy to see anybody in my life.
Well, that's what we figured, and we were talking about how much we missed Mama, and Laura said, well, why don't we go up to Willow Lake and surprise her? So we did.
Did you say that? Oh, I'm glad you did. I was thinking about you. You know that? This is like a dream come true. Yeah. Oh, Tom, it's so good to have her in my arms. You're an angel for bringing her up. Thank you.
Well...
Do you need a little nap? Are you sleepy?
You're on my mind night and day, and it hurts me when we're apart. When you're not here by my side, there is nothing in this world for me. I guess I'm
about a chubby little girl. Who grew up into a very beautiful woman.
Much to say. Brooke, I love you.
This is not the time or the place.
I don't care if Tom hears what I say. I must make up to you the hurt I caused you. I will not go away before we have talked.
You heard what the lady said.
It's all right.
I'm not going to let you stay here with him.
I would not harm Brooke.
I'll be all right. Just a couple of minutes, all right? Won't you be late for your jump?
I canceled the jump. I could not make it. I'm too upset to losing you.
Oh, that's too bad.
you're so upset, why don't you go and see Solange? I'm sure she'll be very happy to comfort you.
Brooke, I don't care about Solange. I care only for you.
You don't care about me. I don't ever want to see you again.
You cannot mean that.
I do mean that.
I never loved before like I love you.
Well, if that's true, I don't think you're capable of loving anybody.
Brooke, I have no excuse. I know that.
Please, Gilles, all right? Just, you make me ashamed that I ever saw anything in you.
I can't change. I never walked on a stump before. Never, Brooke. Don't you realize how much you mean to me?
You and I have very different standards. Evidently, to you, jumping in and out of bed is nothing. To me, it's very important.
I was trapped. I didn't know what went in my
can't
mind.
Can't you understand? I don't care. I don't care about any excuses. I just want you to go.
I think you better do as she asks.
Brooke.
Gilles? Do us all a favor, go back to France. I'll point you in the right direction. What are you doing here?
I'm here to tell you that your attempts to discredit me are not going to work.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, I think you do know what I'm talking about. I've got news for you. You cannot influence every station manager the way you did Warren Campbell.
Did he say he spoke to me? No, I don't suppose he did. First of all, there's nothing to do with Campbell. A lot of people saw your little emotional outburst on your television show. I doubt very much if you're going to get any kind of a job or recommendation from any reputable station.
Well, not if you have anything to do with it. But I tell you what, I'm not worried. You may have some sort of clout around here, but I'll tell you something. The name Ross Chandler doesn't mean much to the rest of the nation. And not only that, I have glowing references from the Bulletin, from my work in Atlanta. I can get a job without references from WRCW.
Well, good, because I suggest you do that, because you're not getting any kind of a recommendation from anyone at this station. As a matter of fact, why don't you do yourself a favor, Brooke, okay? Why don't you just forget the fact that you worked for WRCW in the first place? Get it off your resume. That way you won't be embarrassed in the future.
You're not going to get away with this. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to get a job. And I'm going to be back on top within a year. And the day is going to come when you are going to be begging me to come back to this station.
Well, don't hold your breath on that one.
And I'll tell you another thing. Just bear in mind when you pick up that phone to call me that I'm going to ask double what you've been paying me. To see Laura, but of course she was asleep.
All right, it's your nap time.
Yeah, I didn't want to sit around with Mrs. Cooper.
Well, I'm just delighted you came here, darling.
Uh-huh. What are the two of you up to? I get a very strange feeling when I walk in and I see the two of you with your heads together.
Well, certainly nothing sinister, darling. I just happened to be passing by and I thought I'd stop in and ask Tom how Laura was doing.
I invited you to sit down and have a drink.
As you know, I've always enjoyed Tom's company.
Mm-hmm. Not always.
Since he straightened himself out, I find him one of the most attractive, charming men I've ever known.
Thank you, Phoebe.
I don't think we have to get carried away.
Brooke, why don't you have a seat and tell us what happened in San Francisco?
Yes, darling, please.
Nothing happened in San Francisco. It was a complete washout.
I find that hard to believe.
Well, it was humiliating and frustrating. I couldn't get out of there fast enough. I went to Boston.
You've already been to Boston?
And I've been to Concord, New Hampshire. I tell you, Ross Chandler has done a number on me from one end of this country to the other.
That is incredible.
Well, it's not incredible when you think of the Chandler empire. It stretches everywhere.
Darling, I have an idea. Maybe this is the perfect time for you to take a little rest from your career. You know, just enjoy being a mother. And I'll be happy to help you out.
Thank you. Thank you. I don't want to lounge around on your money.
Oh, for goodness sake, sweetheart. It'd be just until you get your breath, decide what you want to do with your life.
I know what I want to do. I want to be a career person. I want to be a working person that I can respect.
Well, I really better be running along. I I have a meeting. Now you two just stay right here and chat, right?
Joyeux Noël?
Sheila, I want you to go.
Brooke, do you know that I'm doing the big jump tomorrow? I was able to reschedule it.
I couldn't care less, Sheila.
You don't mean that?
What do I have to do to convince you that we're through?
But as a reporter, it could be good for you.
Well, I lost my job, in case you've forgotten.
Well, that's a good way to get it back. I will give you an exclusive interview. What do you say to that? I can't believe you don't care about it. This is the most dangerous I have ever done. I could break every bone in my body.
Do not bother playing on my sympathy. It won't work.
Merry Christmas, Brooke.
Oh, hi.
Here's your present.
This is the best present that I have ever gotten. You know that?
What's he doing here?
Oh, Merry Christmas, Tom.
Gilles was just leaving. And please, take the present with you. Don't put it there, please. I don't want it. Just go.
I will say hello to little Laura first.
She asked you to leave.
We are surrounded by madness, little Laura.
This madness is not going to tell you again. Now get out.
Joyeux Noël, little Laura. Doo-doo.
I don't need this. Gio, please.
Let's have a toast.
I don't want to have a toast. You've already drunk too much already.
Oh, I ruined everything. With you? With my motorcycle jump. Don't you think I had enough suffering today?
Gilles, I feel sorry for you, but I don't want to have anything to do with you. Now, come on.
You don't want me to go, do you? A kiss, Brooke.
No.
And then if you want me to go,
I
will.
No, I don't want you to...
Am I interrupting?
Yes.
No.
Why are you here?
Not that it's any of your business, but I came to deliver a Christmas package for my daughter. It's for my folks. Just arrived today.
Well, she's in bed, so I'll give it to her tomorrow morning, okay?
All right.
Well, you can leave now.
Why don't you give up, St. Clair? When are you going to get it through your head that she doesn't want anything to do with you?
And I suppose you think Brooke rather stay with you? I think you're just jealous that she never cared about you.
Don't you push it, St. Clair.
Don't! All right, stop it, both of you. Stop! Stop! Gilles, I told you before, get out.
You heard the lady.
I go. Au revoir, chérie. This is not goodbye.
I have made such a mess of things.
Now, look, you're not alone. A while back, I made a pretty good mess of things myself. Everybody makes mistakes.
Why does it make me feel better?
Because, Brooke, you're still hurting. But you'll bounce back. You just have to give yourself some time, that's all.
You're a very good person to have in mind.
I'm glad you're back. So is Laura, and so is Phoebe, and so are a lot of people.
I need a job.
You'll find one, Brooke. You just have to be patient. That's all I can tell you. I gotta get back to the goalpost.
Okay, listen, thank you. Thank you
for coming over. My pleasure.
All right.
Talk to you tomorrow.
Yeah. Bye-bye. You're kidding. Yeah, sure, I'm interested. Yes. No, you must be kidding. I don't care. A job is a job. I don't care if it's halfway around the world. Yeah, tell me more about it.
French, of course.
How many times do I have to tell you?
I have a feeling this gentleman is angry with me.
Have you been after his wife, too?
Shh, that is Brooke's ex-husband.
You don't say.
Tom, you are not a man. He kicked me out of Brooke's apartment, and then he came back here. A real man will have taken the chance, you know, and made love to Brooke.
I'm don't you see? Show you the way. Now get out of here. Leave me alone!
Hold on, Tom. I want to go back to the bar, Jim.
No, not until you calm down.
Tom, come on.
I want him out of here!
You had better do the asks, Jill.
I'm not afraid of him.
I don't ever want to see your face again, Sinclair. You understand me?
I don't give a damn what you want, Tom.
If you're smart, you'll get all the way out of town before I get my hands on you.
Look at you. No wonder Brooks divorced you.
I'll kill you!
Get your friend out of here! Who needs this? Au revoir, Solange.
It's too bad you survived your motorcycle accident, Sinclair! The world will be better off without
you! Hi, George. How's it going?
Oh, Brooke. Good to see you.
Oh, nice to see you. Listen, is Tom here?
No. He left about half an hour ago.
Oh, did he leave for the night?
I don't think so. Look, he had a fight with that guy Sinclair.
A fight?
Yeah, yeah, but don't worry. Nobody got hurt. I just think he went home to cool off, that's all.
Do you think he's still there?
That's my guess.
Well, listen, I think I'll give him a call.
Well, listen, use the bar phone, okay?
Okay, yeah, thanks.
All right.
Where he went.
I want you to make sure nobody touches anything, nobody moves anything, all right?
Yes, sir.
Now, would you try to keep all these people back here? Just keep them way back, all right?
Yes, sir.
Excuse me?
Detective Young, I'm Brian Sanders.
How are you,
I'll talk to you in a second.
In a bit, okay?
Give me 5 minutes.
Very sorry. I heard that you were close to him.
I just so ironic, I mean, he's a man who climbed the Chandler building that he should fall off the balcony. I just can't believe he's dead.
Excuse me, girl. Sorry.
Brooke, honey, would you give me a statement? Something I can use when we use tonight.
Are you out of your mind?
Excuse
young
me,
man.
Professor. Come on, Brooke. Crazy. Honey, you know I'm just doing my job now.
Brian.
Come on, Greg.
Lay
look, you know the public could be interested in your.
Uh-oh. Brooke, it's Solange. It's showtime.
Where is he? Where is he? Gee, I love you. Oh, my darling, please, don't
must be dead. Oh, please, wake up, Gilles. Come back to me, please. Come back to me, Gilles.
Wait.
Come back to me, Gilles. Please. Oh, Gilles. It's you. You killed him. You lured him to this filthy little town.
Lawrence, can you slow down just a second? You lost me there on filthy little town. Can you go about a little slower?
You killed him!
Slush.
You killed him! You killed him! You killed him! You killed him! You...
Detective Young, could you spare a minute?
I'm really kind of busy right this moment.
Please, I need to know how this happened.
All right, it could be a few possibilities, all right? It's an accident, or it's a suicide. Maybe the guy got murdered, all right? That's all I know for now.
Jesse, are you absolutely sure that you saw Tom there?
Sure, I'm sure. Why? What's the problem?
It's not a problem. I'm just a little concerned. Well, I don't know if you guys know. See, Tom has had a drinking problem in the past.
Well, I know that he was pretty bad off about a year ago. He was very emotional when your marriage broke up.
Well, whatever the reason, you know, fighting alcoholism is tough, and Tom has had some problems lately.
Well, what's that got to do with me seeing him at the Valley Inn?
Well, I get concerned. You know, maybe he'd fallen off the wagon. Did you see him in the bar?
No, he was in the lobby, right next to the dining room.
No, I'm sure, Brooke, that he was there on business, not to drink.
Yeah, check that out. I mean, anybody that had a drinking problem and wanted to hide it, I mean, they would head to Locust Street, not the Valley Inn.
Well, it's just that he takes care of Laura a lot, so it, you know, makes me nervous if I think he's...
When it comes to Laura? Tom would turn himself inside out, Brooke. I wouldn't worry about that.
Well, let me take a minute and look at these contact sheets again, okay?
I feel like a world-class heel. Look, I never should have yelled at you like that.
I admit I was surprised.
I just got carried away, Brooke. I do respect you. Can you forgive me?
Consider yourself forgiven.
Thank you. Look, I hope you understand that my apology doesn't mean that I've changed the way I feel about what you're doing. I still think it's a mistake for you to do those articles.
I see. So you're just sorry because you criticized me too loudly, is that it?
I'm sorry because I caused hard feelings between us. Look, I don't want to see you hurt anymore. Look at your whole history with Gilles. He caused you trouble with your job. He interfered with your ability to be a good mother. He betrayed you with another woman. Why do you want to relive all that heartache? It just seems to me that it would be best for your own happiness just to put him out of your mind completely.
I appreciate your concern, but it's something I have to go ahead and do. I've signed a contract, you know.
Oh, you can get out of it. Tell him you're not well. Tell him anything, but don't put yourself through this, please.
Look, my mind is made up. And you're not going to stop me by telling me how unpleasant it's going to be.
Have you stopped to think of what this is going to do to your career? Look, you've built yourself a reputation as a first-class journalist. You go and write stories for the National Intruder, you'll lose your integrity. There'll be no decent news organization on the whole planet that'll even consider hiring you.
Look, without a job, I don't have a career. And as far as my integrity is concerned, I think you should leave that be my concern and be, you know, concerned about your own integrity.
What's wrong with my integrity?
Never mind. It doesn't matter. Look, you're not going to stop me. I am going to write this article on Gilles.
You are, without a doubt, the most stubborn individual I have ever known. I don't know why I thought I could come over here and reason with you.
You are avoiding me, Brooke. I not only called you from New York, I called last night and got your babysitter. Didn't you get my messages?
Yes, I got them, and yes, I have been avoiding you because I don't want to hear any of your I told you so messages about Gio.
Isn't this all what I called you about?
Well, good. Because I don't want to rehash my relationship with him. I was extremely upset by his death, and I do not want to hear him criticized.
Darling, I didn't come here to speak ill of the dead. I came out of concern for you.
Well, that's a very familiar ploy.
Usually your concern means that you're getting ready to give me some advice.
What's wrong with a little good advice?
Nothing, except I don't want to hear it right now, all right? I'm upset. I just want to be left alone.
Well, now you listen to me. The reason why you're in such a state is because you agreed to do this terrible little series about Gilles' life and death in that dreadful National Intruder.
I don't want to talk about that either.
Well, you are going to hear about it. Now, sweetheart, this is not in any way a criticism of Gilles, but to involve yourself back in his life and death like this is just exasperating your nerves.
I have signed a contract, all right? It was my decision, and I am abiding by it.
But why do you want to abase yourself this way? Why do you want to disgrace yourself and your little daughter? I mean, is it for the money? If you won't take a loan from me, then take it from Tom.
No, it's not just the money.
Well, then what for? What reason?
I don't want to tell you, all right?
Why won't you tell me?
Look, don't push me, because I'm going to fight you. And I'm sure you don't want an ugly scene between the two of us, do you?
No, I certainly don't. I also see that I can't reach you. All I can possibly do is stand by and watch you destroy yourself.
Hello.
Hi, Brooke, it's Cliff. Listen, I just got the lab reports on that stain that you asked me to look into. Your suspicions were right. It's human blood, and it's very recent.
Is it Gilles' blood type?
Oh, no, it's definitely not.
That's what I was afraid of.
Brooke, look, I did this as a favor to you and not asking any questions. Now I want some answers. What is going on? Exactly what's going on?
I can't. Not until I know more. So according to the lab, the stain does not match Gilles' blood type.
Oh, it's definitely not. I've got the lab report right here. That's his autopsy. It says his blood type, O positive.
Here's the report.
From the blood stain that you gave me. A positive.
Exactly how old is the blood?
Well, it says right there. Couldn't be more than 48 hours old. Brooke, tell me, what is going on here?
I guess I do owe you an explanation. It can't go any further than this room.
Oh, come on. Of course it won't.
I found the blood stain in Gilles' hotel room. And according to the findings of your lab, it's Tom's blood type. A positive.
Okay, so it matches Tom's blood type. What does that mean?
It doesn't mean anything. It just has me worried about him, that's all.
Oh, wait a second. Somebody could have checked into Gilles' room after the accident.
No. I bribed one of the maids to let me in, and she said the room had been closed off to everybody since the accident.
What do you mean closed off? By the police?
No, by the hotel manager. He just didn't want any adverse publicity by, you know, curiosity seekers in there.
Are you just snooping around there to write this article?
That's how it started, but, you know, I can't do anything with this information if Tom really is involved.
You honestly think Tom is involved?
No, I don't. There are just a lot of facts that have me worried about him, that's all.
Oh, okay, fine. What are the facts?
He hated Gilles. He hated him, I mean, for what he did to me. He said in public that he wanted to kill him at the goalpost in front of a lot of people.
That doesn't prove anything.
I know it doesn't prove anything. I'm just trying to tell you why I'm upset when you told me that the blood stain matched Tom's blood type.
Okay, fine. Give me the other facts.
He had a very convenient excuse for where he was the night that Gilles died.
You talked to Tom about this?
I couldn't ask him directly, but he swore to me that he was nowhere near the Valley Inn. He said he'd had a blackout, an alcoholic blackout. Who am I to not take his word for it?
Okay, Brooke, listen to me. The police investigated this whole thing. They don't make these decisions offhand. They determined the cause of death as an accident.
I have full confidence in the police, but I found that bloodstain in Gilles' room behind the lamp. So it's obviously... they overlooked it, right?
Okay, this is all circumstantial evidence. It is, Brooke. It doesn't prove that Tom didn't, and it certainly doesn't cover the fact there could have been any number of people that went through that room that night.
But you have to admit there are certain things that have happened that make it look like it wasn't just a drunken fall from a balcony.
Why don't you tell Detective Young about this?
No, I don't want to do anything that is going to railroad Tom.
It's not for you to decide, Brooke. That's for the courts to decide.
Police could have done this investigative work, you know.
Okay, so you're trying to clear Tom, right?
He's innocent until he's proven guilty. You know, since I'm the one who sort of uncovered all this circumstantial evidence, then I have to be the one to either find out that he's involved or to find evidence that's going to clear him clear, you know, totally.
What are you going to do if after you find out everything, the finger still points at Tom?
If there's evidence that shows that without a shadow of a doubt that he's involved, then I guess I'll just have to go to Detective Young and fill him in.
Look, I know you're writing this whole article about Gio. Are you putting any of this stuff in there?
I'll have to worry about that when the time comes.
Good luck.
Okay, listen, thank you for doing the work, and thank you for being a sounding board for me.
You gonna be all right?
Yeah. I'll give you a call, okay?
Okay.
Hi. Okay.
Here's that set of photos you wanted. I knew you were in a hurry.
Thank you. I appreciate your rushing them for me. Yeah. These are great. Listen, you're not going to get paid for them until the intruder publishes it. Is that okay?
No, Scott, I'm very familiar with the routine of that publication.
All right. Well, I can pay the printing costs for you now.
Oh, forget about it. It's not
want
that much, Brooke. It's not that much. But listen, I have to go back to the shop right now, but I want you to let me know if you need some more help, okay?
Okay, I think this is it.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
All right. Thanks again.
Anytime, Brooke.
Bye-bye. Bye. It wasn't an accident.
Dr. Warner here.
Yeah, hi. Cliff, it's Brooke. Hi. I just wanted to check with you and make sure that you and Bobby are still on for dinner tonight.
Oh, you bet we are. We're looking forward to it. Bobby can't wait to meet Laura.
Oh, well, she's looking forward to meeting him, too. Listen, could you bring a copy of the coroner's report with you when you come? I would like to look at it again.
Wait a minute. I thought this was strictly social.
Oh, yeah, it is. I'm not going to pick your brains. I've just come up with some new information, and I would like to check it with the autopsy report on Gilles' death.
Well, now I am curious.
I'll tell you about it when I see you.
Look, the point is, if I'm going to clear Tom in my own mind, I need to get my hands on every shred of evidence that I can. Dre's motorcycle accident. This was part of the series that was taken after his fall from the balcony. Do you notice anything that doesn't jibe with the autopsy report?
You mean the bruises on the cheek?
First of all, he could not have sustained those by his fall from the balcony because he landed on his back. And he definitely did not have them after the motorcycle accident. So do you think maybe he might have been involved in a fight?
What you're saying is you're trying to tie these to the bruises on Tom's knuckles that night, huh?
I don't want to think that Tom is involved, believe me. But I have this gnawing feeling that he might have been. I couldn't sleep last night. I'm so worried.
So you're going to try to put these in your article?
Well, I can't do that. I mean, basically, I know it's still conjecture on my part.
Okay, well, you got two choices then. You go to the police or you get this off your mind, Brooke.
Why not do the articles?
Look, you're going to drive yourself nuts. This, you support your own theory and prove it, or you accept the police's decision that Gilles' death is accidental.
But these pictures indicate something different than that.
Nevertheless, I think you should leave this whole thing alone and bow out of this article altogether.
Things have me in a bind. Excuse me.
Yeah.
Hi, Miss English. I hope I'm not disturbing you.
Oh, no, of course not. Come on in. Detective Young, Dr. Warner.
Hi, yeah. We've met. How are you?
How are you, Dick?
Good to see you. It won't take long. I just wanted to ask you about your investigation.
Well, look, I'll go in and check on the kids, okay?
What do you mean, my investigation?
Well, it seems you've been asking some questions around town. The Valley Inn, the coroner's office.
Oh, well, you know, I told you I'm doing a series of articles on Gilles.
It's okay. It's not a complaint. It's just that I was wondering, you seem to have some questions about that accidental death report.
Well, I was just trying to gather facts. That's all for the story. Why do you think I have more information than you do?
Well, you seem to bring up some good points. Now, St. Clair was a trained stuntman. And even if he had been drinking, I think his instincts would have told him to try and brace his fall.
Uh-huh. So what are you getting at?
Well, the same thing you were getting at. Maybe it wasn't an accident.
Well, I was merely gathering material for this. You know, I don't, I really had no preconceived ideas about anything.
Well, even so, you got me to thinking. Now, he failed at that stunt he tried, and he lost a lot of money. Now, besides that, he was very despondent over his breakup with you. The way I see it, he may have been suicidal.
I have no idea.
Well, you do have to admit he did have the motivation.
Well, you know, I'll admit that it's certainly something to think about. I mean, especially when you consider his line of work. You know, he certainly risked death a number of times throughout his life, so I guess it could indicate that he might have sort of a death wish. You mean you arranged for Solange to meet us here today?
She should be here any minute.
Prepared to do an interview with her.
Well, look here, you're an experienced newspaper woman. This is no problem for you at all.
Look, she is a difficult subject. I already had a scene with her when I interviewed her on the air, and I lost my job because of it.
I saw the tape of that, but she was very pleasant on the telephone.
Sure, that's because she wanted something. Look, you made the appointment. You can cancel it.
Well, I'm afraid it's a little too late.
You will never get away with this.
What?
Do not pretend. You know you are guilty.
Look, I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't even know why you're here, frankly.
I am here because I care about the truth.
Miss Chevalier, my name is Winston Harding. We talked earlier on the telephone.
Mr. Harding, I am so glad that you are here. I have come to tell everything that I know, and I want you to hear it all.
We all want to hear it, Solange, but as I've told Mr. Harding, I'm not prepared to interview you today, so we're going to have to postpone it until a later date.
No! I will not let you brush me off.
I have no intention of brushing you off.
Are you afraid to talk to me in front of Mr. Harding?
I am not afraid of anything concerning you. Why would you think that?
You are afraid because you want to suppress the truth about Gilles' death.
The police have already issued a report.
The police have reported a cover-up.
And just what is the truth?
The truth, Mr. Hardy, is that Gilles' death was not an accident. She murdered Gilles.
I'm afraid I don't understand anything at all.
Well, she's obviously out of her mind, so there's really nothing to understand.
Nothing, except the fact that this lady has it in for you. Well, I really have to be going.
Mr. Harding, please, no. I have not finished everything that I have to say.
Well, just fill me in some other time. And, Brooke, don't forget you have exactly 1 week for the next installment. And for both our sakes, let's just hope it'll be riveting. Ladies.
Well, if you were trying to impress Mr. Harding, I think you succeeded. You made a fool out of yourself.
I know what I am talking about.
Keep it down. I have a child in there asleep.
Admit it, Brooke. You could not handle a man like Gilles. But you still wanted him all for yourself. Hmm?
Oh, I know that you pretended to wash your hands of him, but you still wanted him. And then when you realized that he preferred me to you, you were insanely jealous. Then you decided, if I cannot have him all to myself, then nobody can have him, and so you killed him.
You know what? I think you've been drinking too much cheap champagne.
It was a crime of passion, and I will prove it.
I think that's going to be rather hard to do. For starters, I could not have shoved Gilles off of his balcony.
Well, if you did not do it yourself, then you had somebody do it for you. I am positive that somebody murdered Gilles. Gilles, they had a vicious fight at the goalpost. I was there.
Gilles was drunk. They had a minor run-in, that's all.
That was no minor run-in. He threatened, Tom threatened to kill Gilles. He was completely out of control. And so you were able to provoke him into doing your dirty work for you. Deny it.
You better get out of here, or I'm going to throw you out.
Your anger is proof that you are capable of murder.